This is TV Channel 7, Syracuse University.
Tonight on Campus 7 News, Libyan leader Muammar Gaddafi readies his country for a possible U.S. attack. The Japanese prime minister promises to pump up consumer demand for U.S. products in that country.
Sexual harassment charges surface at one of Syracuse University's colleges. I'm Kyle Kraska. All the news, weather, and sports coming up next on Campus 7 News. Good evening. Libyan leader Muammar Gaddafi has reportedly moved Westerners into evacuated army camps that could be targets of a possible U.S. military strike. Despite these reported defensive measures by Gaddafi, President Reagan has ordered the 6th Fleet to head for Gaddafi's line of death and await further instructions. It's also been disclosed that more than 40 United States bombers are en route to night maneuvers in the Mediterranean. Around the world, international leaders are considering restricting the number of staff and officials at Libyan embassies. Meanwhile, Syria has vowed to support Libya against any U.S. attack. It was not disclosed whether Syria would spend troops in combat or if they would just support the Libyan army financially. President Reagan will address the nation on the growing Libyan conflict this evening at 9 o'clock. Japanese Prime Minister Yasuhiro Yakusone met with President Reagan Sunday and pledged to pump up consumer demand for imported goods in his own country. Nakasone, who presented Reagan a tiny Japanese television set, also pledged to slash Japan's $50 billion annual trade surplus with the United States, said senior administration officials. Reagan was encouraged by Nakasone's determination and commitment, said an official, but he also acknowledged that the prime minister provided no details about how he intends to acknowledge the goal.
Campus 7 News has learned that sexual harassment charges have emerged within Syracuse University's College of Law. Campus 7 News Director John Christopher was at the school this afternoon and has this exclusive report.
An anonymous phone caller last night informed me that a committee has been formed to investigate charges that law students have been sexually harassed by faculty members at the Syracuse University College of Law. On this law student's tip, we investigated the matter. This afternoon, we spoke with the School of Law's Assistant Dean Richard Ingalls. We asked him why these charges had not been brought to the attention of the university sooner.
Well, the confidential investigation suggests that it is confidential, and Mr. Forbush is not somebody we immediately think of calling when we're engaged in a confidential investigation. That's why we called him only today.
Ingalls informed me that rumors of sexual harassment had been circulating periodically since 1981, but it wasn't until January of this year that students actually approached the school's administration with allegations. A fact-finding committee comprised of members from within and outside the law school was formed in late March to assess the charges. Finally, a letter dated April 7th, issued by Dean Craig Christensen, was circulated throughout the school. The letter informed students of the university's policies towards sexual harassment and notified students and faculty that a committee would be meeting to discuss the matter with both parties involved.
The committee has had at least one meeting, and they're going to be having several more, reviewing any information that's brought forward to them. We're going to have to wait to see what the committee's recommendations are.
When exactly can we expect, I was told last night that there might be a hearing coming up this coming week. Can we expect some sort of hearing?
Well, the committee will be meeting and having a hearing at some point. It's unclear at the moment exactly when they'll finish that work. As you can understand, a hearing sometimes takes longer than planned.
An offer to meet has been made to both sides in the controversy. After a thorough and fair inquiry has been completed, the committee will make recommendations to Dean Christensen as to the nature and validity of the charges. John Christopher, Campus 7 News.
Two FBI agents were killed last week in Miami, Florida, by two suspected robbers who were also killed in a shootout with the agents. Dade County police officials are shocked at the act of violence, in particular because the two suspects were described by neighbors as being loving husbands and loving fathers who did not have a criminal record. Police officials say that when they first began investigating the case, they were looking for a group of neo-Nazi survivalists. Instead, one of the suspects was a born-again Christian who enjoyed giving testimony in church for his deceased wife. In fact, both suspects suffered through the deaths of their wives. Five other agents were injured in the shootout. These two deaths and five injuries were the most casualties the FBI has seen in a single action in its 79-year history. The United States has begun on plans to launch nuclear reactors in space. The U.S. embarked on a similar space program a decade ago, but then refrained from this mission because no mission could be found to justify the cost. The purpose of this space mission is to aid in President Reagan's Star Wars program.
Coming up next on Campus 7 News, SUNY Oswego students are learning a new meaning to the word terrorism in their current events class. Also, a bread recall in 11 states has consumers all the more wary of contaminations and tamperings in consumer products. We'll be right back.
Seven, Syracuse University.
The State Health Committee Sunday proposed a $55 million state fund to help homeowners combat radon exposure. Radon, the natural occurring gas produced by the environment, was found to be hazardous in large accumulations in homes around Onondaga County. Under this new health committee plan, 50 million homes would be set aside to fight the radon gas and 5 million set aside to do more research on the dangerous gas. Final results of this new research should be available to the public in the spring. And unless more research is done on the radon gas, the Energy Research Center of Central New York estimates that 400,000 homes around Central New York will be affected by the fall.
A Pennsylvania-based bakery is reportedly recalling three types of bread that they suspect may have been contaminated with glass fragments. Officials at Stoneman Bakeries said they discovered several pieces of glass in packages of caraway seeds imported from the Netherlands. They fear some of the glass may have mistakenly been added to loaves of rye bread baked in March and early April. The breads in question were pulled from the shelves of supermarkets in 11 states, including New York, on April 8th. Locally, no contamination of the bread has been reported. Officials with Stoneman are concerned that consumers may have loaves stored in their freezer. They suggest returning the loaves to the point of purchase if contamination is suspected. At SUNY Oswego, terrorism is being dealt with through four lectures in a semester-long current events class. The lectures focus on ethics of terrorism as well as specific examples of terrorism in Libya and India. SUNY Oswego history professor Geraldine Forbes said that the purpose of the course is students to think and inquire more. Forbes say that she tries to present three basic arguments about the definition of terrorism. Those are that they are criminals, that they are, quote, terrorists, unquote, that they are fighting a new kind of warfare, and finally, they cannot be classified because each group has a specific set of reasons for revenge. Many professors believe that despite the recent attention in the media, terrorism is a remote concern to most Americans.
About 200 people gathered inside Manly Fieldhouse on Friday night for a workout with Olympic gymnast Kurt Thomas. Thomas's appearance was part of a two-hour workout session to benefit the American Heart and American Lung Associations, which was part of Syracuse University's Happy Hearts Health, Nutrition, and Fitness Week. Thomas began with some stretching exercises and then talked the crowd through some more exercises. After Thomas warmed up the crowd, he handed the spotlight over to Diane Luber of the YWCA. And straight ahead on Campus 7 News, Coney Burgess talks to Adam Moskowitz, a member of the Syracuse University debate team who recently went to the Nationals. And we'll have more news from around the SU campus next on Campus 7 News.
The Shaw Living and Learning Center was evacuated Saturday afternoon after a defective heating unit caused smoke to build up in the hall's dance studio. Syracuse Fire Department Lieutenant John Schaefer said that it was a minor defect in the heating unit and that only a small size haze was caused in the dance studio. The university physical plant will replace the transmitter.
Lowell E. Davis, an administrator and biology professor here at Syracuse University, has been offered the job as dean of the St. Petersburg campus of the University of South Florida. University of South Florida Provost Gregory O'Brien informed Davis of the job offer on Thursday and invited him to go to the campus and visit the university. If Davis accepts the job, which pays $70,000 annually, he will be the first black dean of the University of South Florida's, he will be the first black dean of University of South Florida, and he will be the university's highest ranking black administrator. And now it's time for sports with Mike Trico, and you've got a hot story on the Mets here. They doing all right?
Well, JR, it's a tough start for the Mets. You know, we start with baseball, where the New York Mets opened at home for the second straight year against the St. Louis Cardinals, JR. And as we move over here, we'll tell you that it was a rematch of last year's National League East pennant chase towards the end of the season. Well, if you remember the opener last year, the Mets lost to the Cardinals in 13 innings by the score of 5-4. Well, today, the Mets came up losers again in their opener, losing to St. Louis in extra frames. We go to Shea Stadium on a beautiful day in a sold-out crowd for this one. They've been sold out for a month, as a matter of fact. And the Mets got off to a good start, as you'll see in a second. Tim Tuffle with the sacrifice fly to the right field that brings in the run, scored by Ray Knight. And it was 1-0 for the Mets in the second inning. We go to the seventh inning. Watch this play. It's an exciting one. A pop-up to short left field. Shortstop Rafael Santana will go back for it. And he says, I got it. He loses it in the sun. But George Foster there to help out with some teamwork. Foster will catch this fly ball from Willie McGee. Unfortunately for Met fans, it scores Ozzie Smith, and the Cards take a 2-1 lead. We go to the ninth, where Darryl Strawberry rips a single to left center field. That'll bring home Wally Backman, and the bacon comes home, and we're even at 2. But in the 13th, tied at 2, this ground ball through the legs of Howard Johnson, 1 of 4 St. Louis runs. The Cardinals go on to win it, 6-2 over the Mets. The New Yorkers now have lost for the third straight time. Only 4 hits for the Mets in that one. Bruce Perenni picks up the loss. Elsewhere in baseball this afternoon, the American League scores were there quick. You didn't see them, though. Toronto lost their opener to Baltimore 2-1. Boston trounced by Kansas City by the score of 8-2. And going on right now, Texas leads Milwaukee 3-0 in the fifth. Well, the Syracuse Chiefs stay in Virginia tonight, and the Southern hospitality has been mighty nice to Doug Ault's ball club thus far. The Tribe sweeping the curtain-lifting season series over Tidewater, and now it's to Richmond, where Luis Leao is pitching, and in the third inning, the Braves and the Chiefs, that game is scoreless. Also in baseball, former Los Angeles and Brooklyn Dodger pitching ace Johnny Podras in stable condition in a hospital in Glens Falls, New York. The 55-year-old Podras suffered a heart attack in Glens Falls back on Thursday. And speaking of legends, yesterday in golf, the greatest golfer of our time silenced his critics. They've been saying for a long time that Jack Nicklaus is just too old and he should stop golfing before he embarrasses himself. Well, the man they call the Golden Bear hadn't won a tournament in 2 years until yesterday, when the bear came out of hibernation, Jack Nicklaus winning the 50th edition of the Masters. Jack played well. He shot 1 under par on the front nine, but exploded on the back nine, starting with this eagle on number 11, and he knew his putter was working well.
My putter was working the right way, and, you know, it's kind of funny. I haven't been able to make my putter work until I get myself into pressure situations. When I get in pressure situations, it seems to work better. I guess maybe you need some things to charge you up sometimes, and certainly I got charged up today.
Well, Jack did keep it going on the green, sinking putt after putt, and on his way to a 30 on the back nine, and a memorable title for the Golden Bear.
Had, you know, great thrills at Augusta, and great thrills of winning the Masters, but today I've never finished any of them off like I finished this one off, and I just, you know, I don't know whether I'll ever do it or not, but frankly, right now, I don't care.
Jack Nicklaus winning his 20th major championship. Well, with one of the golf championships out of the way, we go to the NHL and the NBA, I should say, where they're in the process of deciding their championships. Yesterday in the NHL, the Rangers and St. Louis Blues both had the chance to eliminate the favored clubs they were playing against in the NHL playoffs, and they had the chance to do it at home. The Rangers had the crazy Madison Square Garden fans behind them, and they got off to the early start, as we'll see from first period action. Madison Square Garden last night, Mike Gridley, the good play, centers it to Pierre LaRouche, and the Rangers took the 1-0 lead. But the team from Philadelphia came on. The Flyers scored twice in the first period. Peter Zezel gets the first of the 3-goal hat trick right here, and the Flyers took a 2-1 lead. In the second, it was good night, Rangers. Tim Kerr down the right wing fires one past John Van Beesbrouck to make it 3-1, and just 31 seconds later, the Flyers took a 4-1 lead as Peter Zezel scored. The Flyers win game 4 of the series, tied at 2, with a 5th game coming up in Philadelphia. Warren Hedding also happy. His Minnesota North Stars forced a game 5. That goal by Brian gave Minnesota a 7-4 win over St. Louis. Those teams are tied at 2, and both the North Stars and Flyers can eliminate the St. Louis and Broad Street Blues at home on Tuesday night. Finally, the NBA playoffs start Thursday. One final note, Dom Perno, the head basketball coach at UConn, has said, I've had enough. He's resigning from Storrs, Connecticut. That's the third Big East coach to jump ship this year. The SU lacrosse team still number one off the big win against Cornell, and the Orangemen will take on Air Force in the Dome Thursday, and that is it in sports, JR.
Thank you very much, Mike. All right. And finally tonight in Solon Springs, Wisconsin, this is a rather bizarre story here. The city in Wisconsin only has one police officer, and he recently quit his job. He did this because town officials banned him from exceeding the town's posted speed limit. But the catch here is that they banned him from, I can't even say it myself. They banned him from exceeding the speed limit even when he was chasing speeders. You believe that? Crazy but true, yes.
Well, now let's take a look at the weather for the Syracuse and the vicinity. Tonight it will be mainly clear with light winds, and the overnight low will be around freezing. On Tuesday it will be cloudy with a 40% chance of rain during the afternoon. The high will be in the mid-50s, and tomorrow night partly cloudy skies with rain likely, low in the mid-30s. Over to you, JR.
And before we end tonight, we just want to tell you that we have received reports that the United States Navy, through airplanes and aircraft carriers, have begun to bomb Libya. These are reports that have just come into us. But anyway, that is all we know at this moment. But that is our last Monday report for this evening and the rest of the semester. For Kyle Kraska and the rest of the Campus 7 News team, I'm JR Whalen. Have a good evening and a better summer. Good night, everyone.
Good night.